Good afternoon, everybody. And let me just ask Anya if we're all set with the online participants as well. Thank you. So I want to thank everybody for bearing through the morning session, I think is probably the right word. I hope we're off to a good start this afternoon and can really start looking at some of the proposals and determining which other ones we should pull in. I also want to apologize if there was any concern over the way I was managing the queue here in the room. When I tried to call the question in terms of support for a proposal, I was suspending the queue at that point in time and looking for general agreement in the room. There was quite a long list of speakers, sort of 10 or 12 at most points, that I thought were probably speaking to the previous comments, not the motion or initiative, if you will, that I was putting on the floor. But I'll make that more clear if I need to do the same thing again this afternoon. So if we could just ask everybody to take their seats. It's a small room, and all the other background noise kind of carries. So the secretariat over the lunch period, amongst all the other things they were doing, took a look at the top 60, and I think Chengatai is prepared to tell us which workshop proposals by number did not meet those minimum criteria. And again, according to what we had agreed this morning, we're going to asterisk those and set them to the side for a moment. They're neither in nor out. They're just set to the side until we actually progress through some of the other reviews. Are you ready to do that, Chengdai?
Yes. Subject to just a double check, I have workshop ID 46, 204, 118, and 225. 204. 118 and 225. Yes, 46 is the first one. Yes. So 46, 204, 118, 225 are the workshops in the top 60 that did not meet the minimum requirements, e.g., if you have a panel, you have to have a background paper.
Mm-hmm. You still have a question, Liesl?
Sorry, if you could just, I'm sure some people may want the numbers again, but I want to know what exactly you're describing as these workshops. Either they didn't meet the minimum requirements, which were they the ones regarding a report and a background paper?
Yes.
Both. So 4 out of 60 didn't meet those requirements?
Yes.
That's not bad.
It certainly is better than what the earlier discussion.
Yeah.
It certainly left me believing, so I think that's very, very good. Now, we had also said there were 4 other categories that we wanted to evaluate with respect to filling out the other 40 slots. And that was going to be some from the standard deviation group. The secretariat had pulled together the top 30 that had the largest deviation. Another one was the first-time proposers, developing countries. And then, of course, there was a notion that we would take the next 25 below the 60. I'm pretty agnostic about which, category we might move towards at this point. At one level, the logical thing would be to work down through the next 25, and that would give us, I think, a pretty good profile then of the ones that the MAG actually rated quite high, which should mean they've got good support and good confidence of everyone here in the room. And depending on how far we get with that today, we could then ask the secretariat to rerun some of the diversity statistics so that we had that in front of us before we go to the first-time proposers, developing countries, and I think the greatest standard deviation is possibly in a different category, but I see lots of heads nodding around the room. Is that enough? appropriate way to go. So that means we're starting with workshop proposal numbers. We're starting with a workshop proposal that is designated as number 61 in the Excel spreadsheet. I don't actually have that open in the moment, but maybe Chengatai can call that out. We want to go from 61 to 85, and we could either walk through each one of them quite quickly. That might be the best, and just see if...
Going from 60, row number 62.
Yes, or yeah. Whatever the row, yep. Mm-hmm. Row number 62, and just go through quite quickly and see if anybody... I guess, wants to comment on the proposal, either from the point of inclusion or not inclusion. My assumption is that these meet the criteria as well, but in the background, I'd actually like to ask the Secretariat to just do that quick check too, because in fact, if they don't meet those criteria, then we should asterisk them and set them to the side, just as we did with the earlier batch. Jivan, you have a question?
You took out the four, so it's basically highest grade, 60. Yes, you took out the four, and then, yeah. Okay.
So what number?
117.
Oh, so 62 on our sheet.
Is that 62 on our sheet?
Just to be clear, when Chengatai says he took the four out, he didn't take them out of the spreadsheet. His numbers hasn't changed by row. He's just coloring them differently to set them to the side.
No, so this is not the four. We've taken out the top 60, and now we're starting at number 61, the 61 highest graded workshop. Yeah.
Is it? Oh, then there's something wrong then.
What are you looking at? What is your 60th, your 61st? Because the first row number one is the header row, so we don't count row number one.
So for ease, maybe we should use the Excel spreadsheet row number,
yeah.
Which I guess is 62.
62.
Which would be the 61st one rated.
Yeah.
Jovan, you have the floor.
In the ranking, you just tell us the ID number, and we'll look at the ID number.
ID number 170.
And let me just check. Salah, did you have a comment or question as well?
Sorry, I just wanted to comment that the dashboard has been opened by the Secretariat to all the MEG members, in which we made our individual scores. So we can always open that up too.
Yes, that's correct. So you can go into the evaluation, the site, and then you can look at your comments because there were some requests that some MAG members wanted to look at the comments that they made for each workshop. So you can do that now. Just go to the IGF website where you inputted in your evaluation scores and you can see your comments.
Juan, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I have a couple of questions because I'm not really sure that I understand the exercise that we're doing. We are taking out those from the list or whatever, but with which proposals we're going to replace it? We're going to continue the list, the way that the list goes. So if, for instance, if we take out 10, only the 10 following will go in. If that is the case, then I want to tell what I asked for the floor this at the end of this morning, to say two things. First, merger is important. I know that it's difficult, but it's important for two reasons. First, because if we merge two similar workshops that are in the top 60, we clear one slot. A slot is very valued asset here. So, and on the other side, also to have two very similar workshops, it doesn't make sense. Of course, we need analysis. And that is why I agree with what Levan says. If this is going all going to be done by the scoring, then we should not come here. Maybe we could have a software to do it, or maybe an expert system based on rules, and it can be done automatically. We have to be here because we have to reason. In merger, we need to reason. I could put an example from last year in João Pessoa. We had two workshops on Yana transition. But both were relevant because one was from the ICANN point of view we're doing, and the other was from the other point of view. So both, it was two points of view in the same, so both it was relevant. We did that analysis and both were kept. So we need to do that analysis. And so going back, what I think that we have to do, as the representative from Russia said before, I think that it's good to, because I believe in rules and I believe in scoring. As a matter of fact, I defend in the diversity in scoring. But that is not cast in stone. That is only a guide. And in order, it serves off to move. But if we have no diversity, regional diversity, or we don't have the diversity on the proposer stakeholder group, and if you don't have diversity in topics, that is why we're here. We have to do that analysis and that criteria. As Ivan says, we have to be wise and do it. Because if we are only taking out and moving the list up, we are not exercising that discretion. That's why we are here for. So that's my comment.
Yeah. No, thank you, Juan. I'm not sure that we're actually in disagreement. So let me just back up for a moment. When the secretary put up the chart this morning that showed the various diversity profiles against the top 60, the top 85, and the 260, they were all fairly close. So whether we start at the top 60, I think the profile we had in the top 60, whether it was first-time proposers, stakeholder group, or developing country, was by and large fairly close to the 260 that came in. We can certainly and fully expect to keep track of that over today and tomorrow so that we, you know, maintain, I think, that relative profile and, in fact, augment or increase some of them if we think that's more appropriate. So this isn't just a numerical exercise. With respect to looking at two proposals in the top 60 and addressing whether or not they're mergers, I actually think that's, you know, a bit like moving the chairs on the deck of the Titanic. I mean, if they're two strong proposals that this room collectively thought were very strong, to ask them to merge is, you know, it really is about, it's about moving a chair on the deck. It's not going to make a significant difference. I think what would be most helpful is once we've got a few more than the top 60 chosen, we can look and see what the, if there is, in fact, any similarity or commonality. Those of you that said these two proposals are very similar and maybe could be merged, you should look and see if both of them are in. If one of them is not in and the other one in and is rated quite heavily, then I think we need to go with the will of the group to some extent. So I think we fully expect to put a lot of thought into this process, but we need to start to get to the point where we can discuss if we have the top 60 minus the four that we've set aside for the moment, so an assumed 56 as a really strong base that this room actually supported collectively and gave high marks to, what are the other 45, if I just did the math wrong, you know, what are the other 45 or so that we want to pull up and bring in to the workshop selection process? That's what we're doing now. And there were four large categories people said they wanted to look at. First-time proposers. There might be some very, very good ideas in there, but they weren't completely thought out or complete submissions, and we want to support and mentor those so that they do come in. Same thing with proposals which really focus on issues specific to developing countries or from a developing country. I think the other one, Mike's point about the standard deviation, because, you know, perhaps there are some really interesting topics there, which do actually have a wide disparity of views, and we should look at those to pull those in as well. And then the next one was, you know, the I think there's probably a ingrained assumption that out of those three categories, we probably don't find another 55 or so. So we ought to look at the proposals from 61 to 85 or 86, because there should be a fairly high percentage of those that we can pull in. So that's the exercise I think we're in front of us. And we can either move to proposal number 61, which is line 62 in the Excel spreadsheet, and just get a sense as to whether or not people really feel strongly that that should be in, or it's one which we could set to the side, or is it redundant, or were some of these marked lower because you thought they might be merge capability? I mean, this is what we did last year. We literally went through, you know, the next 10 or 20 and said, is there a strong argument for keeping it in or a strong argument for keeping it out? And I think the bias was probably towards keeping it in, again, because it had a high level of rating and a high level of support from across the full mag. The other alternative is I can turn, and I already asked Renata if Renata would like to talk about two of the proposals that come from a developing country that she thinks are important and should be supported to go forward, which might mean we need to take some actions within the MAG to go work with the proposers to help them develop or augment their workshops. We can start at that end if you'd like. In the queue, I have Elizabeth. Just one quick point. Michael's in the queue as well. I want to make sure we're giving time to everybody in the room, though. I did, in fact, have a couple of comments that said it was a little bit hard if you're a first-time MAG member or maybe even from a developing country to feel like you have the ability to jump in as forcibly as perhaps some are and make your point. And I think we all need to work to welcome everybody and allow time for all voices. So with that, Elizabeth, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Lynn. I think I can be quite brief because you started to address one of the questions I wanted to raise, and what I would like to seek from in terms of guidance, because this is my first time as a MAG member. This is my first time going through this process, but it's not my first time witnessing it. And so watching it last year was a good learning experience for me. What I wanted to ask this year was that when we decide on the process to move forward, and we agree that there's going to be some that stay where they are, and then some that we're discussing whether we move others up, etc., that we proceed with a common understanding and acceptance of what the goal is. Because what I found created a problem last year was that we thought we had an idea, but it was sort of broad in what that goal was. And then everyone had their own perception about what they thought they wanted to evaluate and come to some sort of outcome with, and wanted to articulate that in a way in which it was sort of moving us all more towards that direction. And I think as long as before we start the process, we know what those criteria were. And you mentioned the first-time proposers, developing countries, and this notion of the standard deviation. And I think we might need to get a little bit more specificity on what elements we would look at around that. Once we have a common agreement on that, it would be excellent to proceed and kind of stick to that so that our outcome, we feel like we did achieve the goal we wanted and not just lose time debating different people's perception. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Elizabeth. I just need one quick consult with Chengatai because I think he had another good suggestion a moment ago, but I couldn't.
It was just another suggestion that if we go to the top 60, pie charts, for instance, if we want to make sure that there is some balance, we could order the list. For example, in the top 60, we know that there's 60% developed countries returning 78%. So we can order the list according to the grade. We could just select developing countries, people from developing countries who are first-time submitters who, and don't shout at me, civil society, who do not come from civil society, for instance. And in order to, you know, make the balance a little bit more, or who only come from governments who are only 2%, and then we can look at those and then see which ones we want to put on the list, and then we can go down to the next one, the next smallest group, which is private sector, or and then go on like that, or intergovernmental organizations, and then try and just balance those numbers out a little bit. That's one way of doing it, and it's very easy to do on the Excel sheet that we have.
I see a lot of heads nodding. I also still have Michael in the queue, so we'll have go to Michael and then come back and see if there's support for that. Michael, you have the floor.
Just a very quick comment on mergers. You're right, it is hard to take two panels and merge them together, particularly if one is ranked higher than the other. But it is quite easy to merge two panels that are proposed by the same person or the same group of people. This year we have an extraordinary number of panels that are almost exactly the same. They just were proposed three different ways. And in a few cases we have main sessions that are duplicated now in the workshop proposals. So we have to make sure we catch those. The other type of merger that's easy is when there's a relatively low-ranked proposal, but there's a particularly good panelist that could be brought in, and that I think is pretty easy to do. A suggestion on the way we proceed, we might think about looking at five proposals at a time and then just seeing if there's one in there that stands out or two of them that stand out that people want to push forward rather than going one at a time.
Thank you, Michael. And I think that's a good point that, you know, not necessarily all mergers are difficult or of the same value. Renata, you're in the queue.
Yes, I would just also like to refer to Chengatai's comment on sorting out proposals by type. The issue of flash sessions, which is also related to the innovative sessions format. I think we should dedicate some time for that because those clearly, also you have some sessions that, some proposals that are not really flash sessions, so we would need to carve them out of this category.
No, I think that's a good comment. I saw a lot of heads nodding to Chengatai's suggestion that we sort the Excel spreadsheet and look at first-time proposers, and maybe that's or developing country proposers or proposals. And I think that maybe speaks to Michael as well, which is in a group of five, if we think there's a fair amount of commonality between small groups. Are people okay with proceeding that way?
Thank you. Just a quick input. You know that as an IGO, UNESCO is in an embarrassed position because I saw that in terms of geographical scope, we were categorized as a developed country. That's not true. We are representing 195 states. I mean, they are global. Even majority are in developing countries. So we can't be simplistically categorized as a developed world. So if you are really going to look at in this category, thank you.
No, I think that's true. Anytime you try to categorize any large number of things, so I don't think we're trying to treat any of this as that definitive. It's more kind of indicative, and I think, you know, by looking at them individually, we can make sure we're nominating them properly. So Chengatai, do you have the sort ready where we could start to look through?
Okay. I can just walk you through what I'm doing and I'll be late and double check me. So basically what I did was that I just copied all the proposals from the line 62 downwards, put them onto a new Excel sheet, clicked the filter, and then what we can do is just to go to the go to the new proposer for instance, and just select yes for new proposer. So that gives us all the new proposers, right? Correct. And then we go to the next row, which is...
I can, if you need a bit...
Yes, I think need a little...
Chengetai is trying to do a selection of sorts to get to a smaller grouping that we can, and maybe we can leave a little bit of time for you to do that.
Yes.
And okay, because I do think that's actually a good idea. Then we're grouping like proposals with like intent, which I think a number of reviewers here said was the way you actually reviewed them in any case. Once we get down to the workshop proposal numbers that we're trying to, I think it'll be easy. You all won't have to change your spreadsheets. You can just go to the database, the dashboard for which you actually submitted your scores, or to the Excel spreadsheet, which links you directly to the proposal. So then you'll have all those proposal details there as well. The, you know, in the background, and I see Renata has asked for the floor, maybe we could ask Renata, for instance, this could be a pilot, to talk to one or two of the proposals. I think she said there were two proposals that she felt quite strongly should be considered for inclusion. Have her talk us through them. She can identify them by proposal number, do a short introduction as to why she thinks they should be included. If you think there's some things we can do to strengthen any obvious weaknesses in the proposal, then we should talk about that. And then we'll just open it up quickly to see if there's sort of support for the room for including that as a potential workshop or not. I know it doesn't sound very elegant. It is the way it was done last year and the last few years. At some point, you need to get granular and get to the specific workshop proposals and look for support to pull them in or leave them aside. So, Renata, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would also, just before I talk about the workshop proposals that I would bring up, a category which is transversal, which would be measurements of IGF impact or IGF procedures. Two of the developing countries workshop that I selected, one of them is the only workshop proposal that measures what happens in the region after the IGF happens there. It is a proposal by Northeast Brazil, proposed right after IGF 2015 happened there. So the people from the region talking about what happened in the region after IGF passed there. It's proposal 169, and it had a 3.6 score. And I do believe we need to have in mind those measurements, which are not in any criteria, but should be unimportant data indicative of importance of the IGF. And coming from a developing country, coming from new proposers, this workshop proposal should be definitely taken into account by the MAG. Also, 127.
Actually, Renata, can we just stop with that one there and
right. Okay.
Be interested in seeing if there were any other comments or support for proposal 169? Give everybody a minute to find it in their dashboard or in the Excel spreadsheet. And again, this is the process we used last year where we looked for champions to stand up and talk about why they thought the proposal was worthy of a workshop slot and engaged in some relatively brief discussions and then opted to leave them in or pull them out. Give you all just a minute to look it up. You said it was rated 3.6, right? It's row 138 in the spreadsheet that was sent out. 148.
Thank you. I found it so difficult to proceed in this way, Lian. Last year, I remember what we proceed that way. Yeah, we keep top 70, and then we go through the list. It's easy for all of us to figure out which one is what. And then we go through maybe the next 20, 30. And then we have maybe 20 or 30 slots that are flexible if anyone can pump up with what they feel strong about it. In this way, I feel it's more fair because we still respect the scores by the MAG member. We already got our experts. We should trust them. Their judgment, they have really valued every proposal considering all the dimensions. We should really sufficiently respect this order. And then we really have an opportunity to look at every proposals in order, in the priority set by the MAG member. And rather than going too early to the ad hoc proposals by some. So I'm just a little concerned about, I think last year it went well. Well, because in this way, and also maybe Mike said that it's more practical that we can look at every five proposed together after top 60. We go through the from 61 to 65, and then every five, and then people can come up whenever they feel something very strong about it. Would this be better procedure rather than going to the sheet? I couldn't find it, actually. It's so difficult every time when somebody come up with a number. Numbers, it's just not working so well as what we did last year. Sorry to intervene. I'm not a MAG member. Just as an observer, I feel it's more comfortable with in that way. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. We can certainly do that if it's easier for everybody to manage through the spreadsheet that way. I think, you know, that means we probably have a bias towards those that were rated more highly. But then I would also request that we come back and we do look at some of the other categories that people feel strongly about, that we've had a couple of strong interventions that really say it's probably worthwhile looking at some of the developing country proposals and the first-time proposers to see which ones, which maybe weren't rated quite so high, still have a lot of good ideas and can, in fact, be mentored and nurtured in. That is a big piece of what we all said we wanted to do and a big piece of the diversity we were looking for in this workshop selection. So, Jack, you have the floor.
Thanks, Lynn. I think that makes better sense. So for the next 20, so from what we were doing earlier, right, from basically 62 to 80, so just to go through that first and then see if that makes sense or if there's any strong objections. And then the following, I think there's about 30 left, right, something like that. That's the one where we use the criteria, including the criteria of all of this, developing perspectives from developing countries, new proposal, points that you've raised as well, those to help us then champion and pull through. That probably is a much more logical way.
I think it will certainly be less confusing for everybody in the room. So then the proposal is to look at the 61st through 65th rated, which I guess is on line 62 through 66 in the Excel spreadsheet. And we either have a presumption that they're in unless people speak against them, since they were rated so highly, or we go through each one of them and look for a champion and look for a quick sense of the room as to whether they're in. Please.
Thanks. I'm sorry if I'm misremembering, but for line 62 through the last number you gave, Lynn, do we have an indication of which of those didn't meet those minimum criteria? Because the ones you gave earlier, Chengatai, were 1 through 60, right?
Yes.
So that might be a way to at least have a... Sorry to ask for another calculation. I know you guys are spending a lot of hard work doing that. I appreciate it.
No, that's a good point. Aubrey, did you just say that 63 didn't...
It was like it was
63 and
69.
63 and what? 69. So 63 and 69
not
would...
As the line numbers, as the... 72 and 85 in terms of the line numbers.
So line number 72 and 85... did not meet the criteria, would be asterisk and set to the side. And I do hope Eleanor or Brian or somebody are keeping a clear track of these. Let me just clarify with...
So it's row 72 and 85, ID number 63 and 69.
And these 46, and are these are ID numbers?
Mm.
Okay, so I know there are professional systems that do this better and probably professional workshop evaluators that do this better than me as well. Chengatai gave us four ID numbers earlier, 46, 204, 118, and 225. So if we can, and Avi's just given us the line numbers, which Chengatai translated to the ID numbers, if we can make sure that we speak ultimately when we're doing things in ID numbers, right, I know. But so we're going to need to be clear whether or not we're on Excel line numbers or ID numbers. So the two additional ID numbers are 63 and 69. That do not meet... the minimum criteria, so are asterisk and set to the side. Chengatai and Avery, was that out of the first 80 then? Out of the first 85? Okay. So just to underline this then, out of the first 85 proposals that were ranked most high by the MAG members, there are six that do not meet the minimum requirement. And I think we all have those numbers now, right? Sure. The six proposal ID numbers that do not meet the minimum requirements that are at the moment just asterisked and set to the side are 46, 204, 118, 225, 63, and 69. So if we go back to the, I've got two more people in the queue, which I'll come to in a moment. And then when that's done, I think the plan is to go back to the Excel spreadsheet, look at line item 62, I guess, Excel sheet line item, see if we can take, again, I don't have the sheet open. I do have the sheet open in front of me, but I can't see it actually. We can either take that one as an individual proposal and look for a quick support as to whether or not it should be in or not, or we can take a group of three or four, as Michael suggested. I'm sort of agnostic either way. At the moment, I have Cheryl in the queue, Sheeta, and then Rasha. Okay, just Rasha has a question.
May I suggest that we maybe go by line number because it's easier to find the ID rather than going up and down?
No, we are. So we're on
line. I thought we were going by ID number now.
We're going by line number. Line number 62.
The reason why we're not going by line number is that some people, like Jovan, had resorted their worksheet. And so it was all messed up. So maybe we should use both.
So Chengatai is suggesting we try and use both because some people have sorted their Excel spreadsheets according to different sort criteria and therefore don't have the original Excel spreadsheet in front. So we can do that, I think, as our first starting salvo. We ought to say the line number from the rated worksheet that the Secretariat sent out. And I will look to Chengatai to give us the ID number that's associated with the Excel line number. So I'll let you do that in a moment. You can line up the Excel line number 62 with whatever the ID number is while I go to Cheryl and Sheeta, who are in the queue. So Cheryl, you have the floor.
Thanks. I just wanted to clarify because I think I'm still confused on a couple of points. When we're saying the minimum requirement, is that the not having the background paper? Is that what we mean? Or are there other minimum requirements? That's just my... I'm sorry? With it being a panel and the background paper. And also the past workshop report.
What we're using at the moment... is that workshop report. If you held one previously, if you're not a first-time proposer, okay. You should have a workshop report. So if you don't have one, you're disqualified. And then if you have a panel and you don't have a background paper, you are put into the limbo.
Okay. And second question, I think I heard something earlier, but I might have misheard. So are there plenaries for the best practice forums and also workshops, or did we decide that we were moving just with plenaries for those?
No, best practice forums and the main sessions are a different discussion.
Completely different discussion.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Cheryl. Sheeta, you have the floor.
No, I would like to support the proposals, but if it's not the time yet for the top 65, then I should do it later.
We've actually passed the top 60. Right, so now we're looking at line item 62, workshop ID number 170.
Yes.
170. So the floor is open to either support, or if somebody feels strongly that that's not an appropriate workshop for the slot, to state so. Please get in the queue, Rasha.
Thank you, Chair. 170 is about Internet of Things, and I found 6 workshops around Internet of Things. 3 of those workshops, I think, are in the top 60. 35, 170 that we're seeing now, and 188. So I strongly suggest at least to do the intent of merger. That could give some slot space. Because, you know, here, between us, 3 workshops on Internet of Things, I think, is too much. Thank you.
I'm not sure an absolute number is a criteria for ruling something out. If we want, we can put those 3 workshop proposals up, look at them, see if we think they're substantially different or not, and if not, the MAG can certainly recommend that we go to a lesser number. 35, 170, and 188.
The whole group, because maybe some on the bottom. So 35, 123, 139, 170, 181, and 188. All those. What? 67 is also Internet of Things? No. El número al lado, no es. Okay, maybe I missed one. Okay.
So when the MAG members reviewed, I'm assuming people noted that there were quite a number on. Are there any proposals coming from the MAG members for either merging or choosing 1 or 2 because they were more substantive than others? I have Jivan in the queue, Marilyn, and Jack. Please use the queue.
I would be against taking out any proposal because there are others in there. And especially in the Internet of Things, I think that this is a topic that I would recommend next year's IGF be about the Internet of Things. I think it's such an important issue that we're not looking at properly. But just 2 cents on that. I don't want to take any more time than that, but I think it's a very important topic.
Thank you, Siobhan. Marilyn, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Let me see if I can just go back for a minute. I think we also talked about ultimately the need to have some balance. And so I think it was very difficult for MAG members to keep track since we didn't have the workshops in clusters. You had to look for both the description and then the tags. I think it was very, so I personally think we either have 6 or 7 workshops on a topic. In order to have balance, I think it's would be overwhelmingly challenging to have 7 workshops on the same topic without our looking at them. I know we're going to have that same number on human rights, that same number on privacy, that same number on access and diversity, but I think we get that many, whatever the topic is, I think we need to park them and come back and look at them. Some of them may fall under the rating, but they might have speakers we could move or recommend moving, and that might mean we end up with 4. But I think we have to think about ultimately balance, but maybe we can't do it at this step. Instead, we flag them like Juan did, so we now know we have 7, and then we come back and we think about how we balance everything. We might regain 1 or 2. I'm going to go back to the question that Cheryl asked, because I heard you say, Chair, that the discussion about the best practice forums and the main sessions is later, but I need to ask a clarifying question. In my notes, I could be wrong, I thought there was the suggestion we were reserving both workshop slots and for both best practice forums and dynamic coalitions. There was a number mentioned of 5 or 11. And then we also have main session proposals for best practice forums and dynamic coalitions. So if we don't decide that if we're going to allow what would be workshop slots to be allocated to all of the best practice forums and all of the dynamic coalitions, I'll just say that we're going to have a challenge. Why? Because the NRIs have agreed to just have a main practice session and not be crowding the workshop slots. So I just parked that for something to come back to understand how we manage space. Thanks.
So Chengatai's just clarified that the slots that are set aside for the best practice forums and the dynamic coalitions, which I believe are at their request, are not part of the 100 workshop slots that are there. And is this same practice as we followed last year? Mm-hmm. So it's the same practice as we followed last year. If the NRIs want some, additional rooms or something so they can do something similar or meet amongst themselves, we can look at a way to accommodate that within the venue. But certainly for best practice forums, these were requests for them, and I think the work they do is significant enough that allocating 5 slots for them for their work is not a bad idea. I think it's a good idea to be on the positive side. If the dynamic coalitions are more worrisome just because they're more numbers, then we can talk to that later. Okay. Michael, you have the floor.
Real quickly, I agree with Marilyn that just because a topic has lots of proposals, particularly if the topic is as broad as Internet of Things or sustainable development, that's not a reason to knock things out. We have to look for similarities. About half of these proposals are actually on Internet of Things in less developed countries. And I wanted to strongly support the one that we were just arguing about, because of the ones that I've looked at, and I know a lot about the Internet of Things, this was the strongest one, in my opinion. And it is very well rated by everyone else, too.
You're talking specifically to workshop proposal 170?
There are some mergers. There is another one. Number 69 in particular is one that could be merged and would bring some more expertise from the less developed countries. But I don't think it's a good merger with this one. It's a better merger with one of the other Internet of Things one.
69 was one of the one we asterisked and set to the side because it didn't meet the criteria. Let me go through the queue. I have Dominique Lazansky. Have the floor, Dominique.
Thank you, and good afternoon, everybody. I have two comments. One is a general overall comment, and then one about this particular workshop in IoT. Just having sat through the morning and also this afternoon, it's clear that we're going to need to think strongly for next year about not just a framework and sort of a set of principles for how we're going to do this next year, but also how we would like to see the content and the workshops displayed and perhaps improve that tool. But I will leave that to the side for now. The other thing I just wanted to say is I know I'm a speaker on this particular IoT panel, but I strongly support the workshop, but I strongly support it as well. Chris was on a panel on IoT in Eurodig, and also he's organized many panels before, and Ripe NCC and the people that he got together other than me, obviously, are it's a really interesting panel. And in general, just to comment on IoT, I think it's probably one of the most important emerging issues that we're dealing with at the GSMA, particularly for developed countries across standards, across enabling a development of everything from access to resources to things like that. So I just completely think that it really needs to be, a lot of these workshops need to be considered because, as Jevon said, it's really, really important. So thank you.
Thank you, Dominique. Herman?
No, I withdraw my opportunity to speak. Dominique and Michael had already mentioned what I wanted to say. Thank you.
And Izumi, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I'd like to join in supporting to make sure that we have 170, proposal 170. The reason being that I think this actually makes very specific approach and relevant to the IGF by the fact that we have other stakeholders, not just the technical community or the people who are directly involved in the IoT industry, but then calling for collaboration between the technical and policy, as well as calling for specific standards for IoT vendors, which is the kind of opportunity that we need for wider outreach and making sure that we raise awareness to the groups of people who are not just related to the IoT itself, but then for wider policy or technical considerations. And that's the reason why I support inclusion of the IoT 170 proposal. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. There's nobody else in the queue at the moment, but let me see if we can progress on this. I also agree I don't think our starting position can be if there's some more than some number of proposals that they're automatically ruled out, or that's automatically a bad situation. Chengatai is checking right now to see which one of the six or seven numbers that Juan read out are actually in the top 85.
Is that 15?
35. I'd like to, right now, I would park those six or seven workshops, and Chengatai can complete the analysis. And, you know, from my perspective, if there were three of them that are in the top 85 or so, then we let those go for the moment. We can note, you know, sort of on a flip chart notion, that there was a comment that perhaps there are too many IoT workshops, and come back and review those if we really find ourselves pressed in some other time, 181 and 188. And it sounds like we should count on 170 coming in. There were significant support from that in the room. So if we go, ask you to change again, Chengatai. if we go to the next batch below the 62 cutoff, what are the, we were looking at the five from 62 to 67 or something are the Excel line item numbers, which I think work for most of you. But for those of you that have sorted them through ID numbers, the ID numbers you need to look up are
from 67?
62 to 67.
So line number 63 is workshop number 60. Trans-Pacific partnership, good or bad for the internet. And then line number 64 is workshop number 6. Can law enforcement catch bad actors online anymore? Line number 65 is workshop ID number 160, social media and youth radicalization in the digital age. Line number 66, workshop ID 30, strategic litigation, freedom of expression online, Southeast Asia. Line number 67 is workshop ID 91, the power of non-commercial users on the internet.
Shall I come from that?
Stop there.
Stop. Mm-hmm.
So again, these are presumed to be strong candidates for the workshop, to be selected as workshop proposals given their high rankings. Is there anyone who wants to speak against any of the proposals that are there or any other concerns with any there in the group? Juan, you have the floor.
Thank you. I'm sorry to take the floor again, but I'm just doing my job because in the evaluation you put a slot for mergers. Otherwise, that's why I'm saying we're supposed to do that. I don't mean that automatically we have to merge. Only we have to, as Marilyn said, to flag it out and then to do the analysis. Coming back to 60, that is Trans-Pacific, we have 5 workshop proposals in that topic. And through my count, 2 of them are in the top 60. We have, you can write it down, then you can check. We have 20, workshop 20, 60, with the one we are looking now, 145, 222, and 246. All those are relating to Trans-Pacific and trade agreements in Trans-Pacific. Then we can take a closer look and see if it's valid to have all those or not, okay? I think it's not the moment now to analyze that, maybe later on. Just we have to flag it, and please do it. Otherwise, I will never mention any merger, but I think I should.
No, I think your comments are very helpful, Juan. So please don't stop. I think it's a matter of, you know, trying to process how many are similar with how many are assumed in. Again, if it's a relatively small number, you know, I don't know if the highest priority work for this group is to go away and look at everything that's around some topic and try to restructure them. We have a lot of workshop proposals to evaluate still. We have noted those that are similar there, though. And again, and Changitai, I don't know if there's somebody else from the secretariat that can even help you, and maybe you can manage the spreadsheet and they can manage when as Juan has just Eleonora. So Eleonora, as Juan has just identified those 6 that are all similar, if we can note those 6 and look and see which ones are actually in the top 85 so we understand whether or not we have kind of the size of the problem we actually have. You have the floor. Juan, you have the floor.
Okay, just as an example, because we are not covering the workshops more up in the list, but I think Mike Nelson mentioned, we have 2 very similar workshops and was proposed by the same people. It is 113 and 115. They are in number 20 and number 23 in the list. And they're very similar and proposed by the same people. So I think we need to take a look at
that. So this is exactly what this discussion is for.
But this is over up. We should not take it for granted, all those lists of 60 up. We have to take a look of all of those. That's why I'm telling you that the the grading is only a guidance. We have to look it.
And
check,
we do.
Check, it, check out 113 and 115 are the same people and similar topics. And so I'm sure there's some others that I missed because, you know, I'm not...
So we will
infallible.
Note those. We will note those and come
people
back to them.
I'm not.
We will note those and come back to those as an exception. That's noted. And I have quite a long queue now. So Salah, you have the floor.
This won't take long. Just to add to one's list on trade, I'll just read out the numbers. They're actually 34, 56, 60, 106, 118, 124, 145, 156, and 222. And I noted that two of those workshops were, at least two, similar thing on TPP, were being facilitated by the same person. That's just to add an extra three.
I think one of the things that's becoming clear, and I think it was Dominique mentioned, I think in future years we should probably do more pre-processing or pre-packaging, probably before they actually go out for ratings. Because, I mean, we haven't even started talking about human rights or privacy or access, which are probably going to have 30, 40, 50 workshop numbers associated with them. So I'm not, you know, quite sure how this particular exercise is going to work as we roll out to some of the others. And I think we have to assume if there are many, many workshop proposals on a topic, then it's because there are many people that are interested in them and of high interest. And I think we need to do our best to ensure that there's not an imbalance in the number, and certainly that they're not redundant, and that the same group isn't putting in the same proposal under two different names. And if people have examples of that, they should call that out. And, you know, maybe we start collecting a list or something that the secretariat can help us walk through. I don't know a better way, and believe me right now, I wish I did know a better way to process through some of those. So let me go back to the list. Siobhan, you're next on the list. You have the floor.
So I think that every year we come to this point where, you know, to merge or not to merge. And I think that there's always this feedback that every year it's considered and the conclusion is it's too complex. And I guess the complexity is that you make two or more workshops, proposals or coordinators say you should meet and then see how it goes. And then it's either a power thing that determines the outcome or something else. But there is perhaps another option. And I think that Juan, first of all, made a good point in the sense that we've given the possibility, but we've never really fully explored the possibility. So if we've given it, we should explore it. And in order to explore it, perhaps the answer is a more active role by some of us or someone to curate a topic. So perhaps, you know, for instance, for Internet of Things, I'd volunteer to curate workshops that are around that and perhaps an active moderation. So you invite the people who are interested in this, and it's instead of a panel of two, three people speaking, a lot more people, and there's a lot, it's a very active. Now, that's a job for either a very skilled moderator or, but it's a skill. So, I mean, it's learned, and perhaps some of us can do it in order to come to some interesting insights on that given issue. So perhaps this is something that we should consider. If there is an area where somebody's interested in kind of diving into and curating this topic to a main session, perhaps. So even if there's a main session on that topic, you curate, you participate in the workshops and then participate in a main session in that form. So that is for that issue. The second is that every year, again, we keep on, there's a lot of good ideas about how to make the process better. And I'm sure that we lose about 80% of them by the end of the year. So just a quick proposal to create a bucket, and the bucket is a mailing list, improvemagprocess@ingov.org, so that anyone who has an idea can just put in a quick like subject line with a hashtag that is in a given area, and then within the body this is what I think about this. This process can be better like this, and that's it. And then that first meeting after the InGov the Internet Governance Forum, we look at that bucket and see, we kind of turn it over and go over it and see what are good ideas, what are worthy ideas, and so just an idea.
Yeah, we could definitely use a better way to track possible improvements and then certainly a better way to advance them. Jack, you have the floor.
Thanks. I just want to support that bucket list, mailing list. That's a really great idea. And just so that we're not going back and forth, can we stick to the going up to 85? And can we not open up every single topic? Because I think you are absolutely right. If there's a lot of workshop proposals that talks about a particular topic, it's because it is of great interest. And if we look through all of it, it's going to be very difficult and it will then end up being a bit of a subjective decision making. But if we wanted to look at repeats, then I think repeats in terms of organizers, that's fair. Yeah, if it's the same organizer, same topic, then that's fair. But maybe after we go through this process, then we go back to see if there's repeats just to make sure we're moving forward.
No, I think that's a very good suggestion, Jack. And I think if we get to close to 85, that leaves us with 15, probably a few more that we can actually flex in tomorrow in terms of those diversity. But that also means that overnight, with apologies to the secretariat, the secretariat can go away and rerun those statistics, and we can look at things such as the proposers and all those other things and come back and do a high-level view. Also, I think if people really are concerned that there are just too many in that top 85, because hopefully by the end of today's session we know what the recommendation at that point in time is for the top 80, 85, we can go away and look at that as well and see if there's too redundant. We can all look at our own ratings and our own and see if there's any topics we want to bring up as exception, because we now think there's just far too many Internet of Things or far too many of. So we can all do that subjective analysis on the 85 and come back and have that discussion tomorrow morning. So there's heads shaking, mostly yes around the room. So with that, I'll just go to the rest of the queue. I have Mike Nelson in the queue.
Yes, I wanted to build on what Juan had to say about mergers, although there are a number of these cybersecurity ones, and the one merger that he proposed I don't think is quite as effective as the merger between 115 and 116, which I think would be a much better fit. The other place I think we definitely need to have mergers is on these panels about trade, because while we sometimes have nice geographic diversity and even gender diversity, for at least three of them, we have no political diversity. Basically, you have the same people saying the same thing and nobody able to rebut them. So for the one that we were just talking about, number 60, I would propose merging that with number 145, which is on digital trade. And I think that would provide some balance and also would get us a stronger panel overall. Thank you. Can I speak up vehemently for line number 64, I believe. It's the one on law enforcement catching the bad guys. Which one is that?
Number six.
Line 64. That was, you know, obviously it was one of the top 63 that we selected. It was also one of the very top in standard deviation, which to me means that there's a good controversy there, and we don't have anybody else talking about these issues, so it's a unique opportunity.
Okay, so if I'm staying with the process here, we have ruled in 170, which was line item 62. I think for the moment we're leaving 60 in, but it feels like there's probably a check we should come back and look at tomorrow to look at whether or not the Trans-Pacific Partnership is overrepresented in the workshops that are there. And there was strong support just now for ID number 6, line 64. Is there anybody that wants to speak against those, so we can go into Jack's strong suggestion that we continue moving through the process that way. We're okay. Lots of heads nodding yes. Peter, you're the next in the queue.
Thank you, Chair. Peter Dengate-Thrush. I just thought I'd begin by saying we have to recall why we're in this position. We lost quite a lot of time because of the mandate decision in December. We would normally have had these earlier and would have had more time, and I think that would have led perhaps to some of this conversation online, and we should look to that next year. First of all, I'd like to agree with Juan. When I was grading these things, I gave a number of competing proposals the same score. Sometimes it was a 5. Because the criteria aren't fine enough for me to discriminate, and so we need to come here and discuss amongst ourselves which of the 5 fives go through and under what process. So I strongly agree with that kind of concept, that we need to have some way of breaking them down, and we need to do it as a group. I've actually voted quite heavily against the two that you're saying we should put in, 170 and 6, and I have a technical question for Chingatai about proposal 6, line 64. This is one of the many proposals that doesn't actually link to a report. It links to the same people having a session in a previous agenda. Now, is that a technical problem? Are we linking to the wrong document, or are we linking to the only thing we've got on these people, which is their previous performance? So can we clarify? I mean, that if you have a look at that particular, and there's many of these, the link is not actually to a report on their session. It's to the agenda item from a previous IGF that says these people are going to run a session. It's a previous proposal, not, in other words, it's the anterior paper, not the posterior one. So if we can check that, because as I said, I found many, many of these are not actually reports, they are, you know, appearances in the agenda, in the calendar, because that might get rid of or cause us to review a number of them. And I'm vaguely uneasy, I have to say, at the idea that there are people championing individual projects. And I'm not quite sure if there's a better way, but what it tends to mean is that those topics or those groups that have good advocates on the mag will get away with more than those who have lesser advocates. And that brings up culture and language and all sorts of issues about who's on the mag and who are good advocates. It's going to prejudice developing countries, new mag members, people who don't work in English. So I'm not sure that there's a better way, but I think we need to be aware that simply because a group of topics has a good bunch of advocates may not mean that those topics are actually any better than any others. And I just record my uneasiness about that as a process. I don't have a better solution, I'm afraid.
No, and I think your last point is very valid. The only thing I would say is that these were ranked, the proposals we're discussing at the moment were ranked very highly by all those MAG members. So that's my kind of comfort cushion, if you will, with this model. I think it does change as we get down to those that didn't have a high level of support. And the two that we just sort of stated were in were on the basis of the fact that they're in the top 80, they got high ranks, a couple of people spoke to them, and there was support around the room for including them, and no strong position for not including them. So that wasn't a chair preference, it was, you know, a reading from the room. I think the other point you mentioned, frankly, gives me a little more pause, which is if, in fact, they really don't have proper reports associated with them. Following our previous conversation where we ruled, where we set aside those 6, we're now possibly having to look at setting aside some other number. And I don't quite know how to assess that. I'm hoping that, you know, some of the adjectives people have used around here come back to us a low number, just as the previous conversation just gave us those 6 that fell out. I don't even know if there's any sort of quick way for the secretariat to go through and make sure that the reports that are associated are reports as opposed to just an other agenda link. I also think that we kind of went through this morning as well and said, and Peter, in fact, it was you who said, I think that's probably a refinement for later if we're meant to judge the quality of the reports and things. I take it there's fundamental difference if it's simply a link to a previous agenda as opposed to an attempted report. But in the queue just now, I have Cheryl, Laura, and Michael. And I do want to make sure everybody's being thoughtful about ensuring everybody gets a chance to take the floor, too. So, Cheryl, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I think just very quickly, in looking at proposals, I guess it's 60, I think there could be better diversity. I think someone mentioned that earlier, but I would vote the same on that. And I think there's a pretty close assimilation between 60 and 20 as well. So I don't know if merger is appropriate or what, but that's something we should definitely consider. Thanks.
Thank you, Cheryl. Let me just check with the, I mean, I assume when comments are made like this, like there could be better diversity in workshop 60, that that's actually noted and that the secretariat takes it away and, okay. I'm just wanting to be sure we don't lose all the value in this conversation. Laura, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Just a point of admin on workshop 6, where it was noted that it linked to the proposal from the previous year. If you click through to the proposal, there is a link from there into the workshop report from the previous year. I guess it's just a kind of admin link in how the website works.
From what I can see is that they do have the links to the report. It's just buried a little bit deeper in the...
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Laura. Julian, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just highlighting again the issue of remote participation. I see on Proposal 30 and 160, that is very poor plans for remote participation. If we select them, I suggest that we encourage to make a better plan so we can get more participation. For instance, 30 proposal has the same person as remote moderator and reporter.
Okay, those are excellent points. We'll note that.
Yeah. I mean, we can send out conditional acceptance. We'll accept your proposal if you make changes A, B, or C or something.
Thank you, Changatai. So in terms of the last grouping we were just looking at, we're down to the last two there, which were line items 65 and 66 and ID numbers 160 and 30. Is there anybody who wants to speak against their inclusion or anybody who has any other things which we think should be addressed before? At this point, I guess, ruling them in.
Hi, this is Ephraim. I went through this, especially number 160. I acknowledge that this is a group of experts. It's a great idea to have this debate, but then My emphasis would be that they increase the remote participation angle, especially because it focuses on the young people, and because the people who are going to debate are not necessarily young people per se, but then also, apart from that, to also liaise with the Mexican government to ensure that the young people who are going to be there participate, especially in this session, because this is something that is affecting us young people, and I can speak as the youngest person in this room, 24 years, that this is something that is affecting us. Thank you.
Thank you, Ephraim. Good comment. Izumi is in the queue next. Izumi, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Regarding Workshop 60, I think that the theme and the topic itself is good, and I support having this. But I don't really see clear description on which speaker will speak for a particular perspective. And I think it would be better to have clarity on how different speakers will share their various positions and perspective on that workshop. So just a suggestion for improvement.
Thank you, Izumi. Juan, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Now I'm confused. Are we talking now of 160? Or are we still in back in 60?
No. It was workshop ID number 160.
160,
which
okay.
Which was line item 65.
Yes. No, because Izumi was speaking about 60. She spoke about 60, not 160. Okay, but now I'm in 160. Okay, again, I'm sorry to say that 160 is in the topic of youth and radicalization and speech, and we have five similar work proposals, and I'm going to say the number so you can write it out, 31, 96, 131, 160, and 180. And of those, 96 and 160 are in the top 60. So maybe, again, we have to take a look if it's feasible to merge those two, because 96 also it's above 160. Thank you.
So I think we can put those two together. I want to make sure we're not trying to set a trend because, frankly, I think that topic is extremely important from both aspects of it, which is neither here nor there. I'm only trying to set a principle that says simply because there are two which have a similar title in the top 60 doesn't mean they should immediately be looked at for a merger opportunity to save a slot. If there's a lot of topics on similar items, it's because there's very high interest in them. So I think we can note that the two are very similar and are in, and we can determine a process where maybe tomorrow we come back and look at these that do have, you know, similarity that are all in the top 60 or the top 80. So we'll look at that. But I want to make sure we're just not slipping into a principle that I... Juan, you have the floor.
Yes, of course, Chair. I'm in your hands. I'm just pointing that out because things are much beauty. If you want, I will never point out mergers, but it was in the... But I don't say that automatically we should do it. We should merge it. I agree with you. This is an important topic, but we have to take a look if it's similar, if the same persons, if it's... We have to take a look. That's what I'm doing. If you want,
I agree, and we've noted it. And as I said before, I do want you to keep highlighting where you think there's a lot of commonality or similarity. So are there any more comments on the last two proposals that were in that last batch that we just put forward? Again, those are ID numbers 160 and 30.
Thanks, Madam Chair. So I wanted to comment on Workshop 160. Like, the reason why I didn't really think it's a good, because it does, on the description, it says a lot about UNESCO and then their project. And I think it's important to accept this, if we were to accept and go ahead with this proposal, to have it in condition that they have more young people involved, because I think this is an important topic, as Ephraim mentioned. And, you know, having them to describe, you know, why. And I'm sure they are really keen to participate because they're activists online, you know, in this context. So I think it's important to accept it on the condition that youth are involved. And similarly, remote participation would be one goal and one means to it. But I think without too much youth participation, I don't think that would be a fruitful discussion.
No, I think that's a good comment. Michael Nelson, you have the floor.
Just agree strongly with what was just said. It is an important topic, but a more diverse panel would be great. Quick question on mergers. Is there any way that we can take the data that we all submitted about proposed mergers to find out if there are places where 5 or 6 or 10 of us all suggested the same merger?
I mean, the obvious answer to that is yes, and I guess it depends on whether or not we're looking at hundreds of possible merger combinations, but we should be able to do that, even if we get clever with respect to sorting it in an Excel spreadsheet. You know, this merger proposal came in and had linked these five, and or I don't know. What do you think, Changatai?
Yeah, we just have to look at the data to see whether or not the mergers are all in one line, or we have to manually go through every single one of the individual ones and manually rate them. Then that will be a bit of a problem. But we can always change that for next year as well, make it a drop-down menu so that the database can automatically count these mergers. But we'll take a look and get back to you on that.
Elizabeth, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I heard you mention ID number 30, which is line 66. And I don't have a problem with the particular proposal, but I wanted to test a way in which we exercise the ability to choose at this juncture, or that we find ourselves choosing by not choosing. So I raised the point that in Changatai's analysis, that freedom of expression is a very heavily overused tag compared to some of the others. And this is a regional proposal. And so I would just like to know whether we want to look at that kind of a rebalancing in pushing aside or not accepting something at this juncture in favor of being able to consider others that might help us balance this. And I really don't have a strong opinion on this particular workshop. It's just to test that idea of, if we accept this because we have no strong objection, we're actually then choosing by not choosing to exclude others that might have a new contribution. So I put that out there. If that's clear, I'm sorry.
No, I mean, I think it's quite clear. Again, I come back to, you know, if it's rated highly by all the MAG members that actually looked at the proposal and they looked at all the other proposals, you know, we can only assume, in the absence of a lot more specific data, that they thought this was worthy of a specific slot. If you're you know, thinking that it's taking away from something, then maybe we can note it, and when we get to enough of the program identified, again, it's not final till it's final, but enough of the program identified, then we could perhaps come back and look at that. Could you give Elizabeth the mic, please?
Thanks. So yes, my concern is only about the rebalancing issue, and that we can't, if part of our exercise in reviewing this, and this is maybe my perception that is not actually something we agree to, is that we don't want to have an imbalanced, overall arching area of subjects. And I'm not saying the number of proposals that are on one particular topic, but I mean overall, we're dealing with this one issue a lot more than all the other issues, and as a result, we think we have an imbalance. We won't get there. We won't get even arrive at the others unless where we have an over representation and perhaps something else that makes this very specific or regional or a little bit less perfect than some of the others that are there. And so I put it out there. But I think it's maybe something we could park into for that rebalancing exercise tomorrow. But I throw it up there.
No, I think... where we are is, if we can get to the top 80 before the end of the day today, then the secretary can go away and rerun all the profiles so we know which stakeholders, which region, which set of tags, first-time proposer versus returning, and maybe then do a does this look sensible, does this look reasonable on the basis of what our goal was when we established the criteria for the workshop proposals and on the basis of what was submitted, because we have to assume that what was submitted is an indication of the interest and what people find, would make a good program. But I think we can do that large look tomorrow when we have the bulk of them. UNESCO, you have the floor.
Thank you so much for the MAG members to support the workshop 160 on social media use radicalization.
Yes, I really fully agree to bring young people to speak and participate. Last year, we did sponsor a Syrian young activist to IGF to Brazil. And this year, we are trying to do the same thing. But, you know, by my definition, the people under 30 years old can be deemed as young. And but then I was criticized again last year that he was not young enough. And he was in his 20s. So how about a teenager? In that sense, I would think it's important that if the Mexico organizer can organize some really a youth ambassador from the middle school, from high school, even university to the IGF. Like this session, I would really welcome that the teenager to be there. They are using they are not using Twitter. They are using Instagram, using different social media. They are really a stakeholder to be there. So if we can organize people to young people from Mexico, definitely they can be there to join debates, to challenge our experts if our theory, our recommendation are valid or not. Thank you.
Yeah, I agree completely, and I think your input is extremely valuable. My approach to it is we need to review even the format of certain panels or certain of the working groups. They have a different conversation. They engage differently. They talk about things in a way that we don't even begin to scratch. This group, and I respect it fully, it's extremely well versed into the technical details, into human right aspects, and so on and so forth. The young generation, really, their mindset is in using social media. They just want to engage. They want to work wherever they want to work. They want to live and use technology differently. So our opinion and perspective is to really change part of that mindset on our own, even on the government side, to understand how to engage with them and how to make it this conversation valuable to them. So we definitely welcome input to do so. And on our side, we're connecting to local colleges and universities to bring them forward and understand how they can have a voice heard and a voice really within the forum. Well, thank you.
Thank you, Victor. I want to try and go for a close on the last two, 160 and 30, are the ID numbers, 65 and 66 are the line numbers. And again, our assumption is that without a specific strong objection, that they are ruled in for this first subset. Sheeta, you're in the queue. Did you want to speak to that directly? Okay. Sheeta, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. No, I would like to support actually the proposals number 30, because this issue is very relevant to Southeast Asia, and there is a really ongoing threat towards freedom of expression in this country, in this region. Litigation does a strategic move, and I think regarding the balancing that mentioned earlier, there is more less than 10 proposals coming from Southeast Asia, so this is actually already a balancing proposals. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheeta. Avra, you were in the queue, but just disappeared. Rasha, you have the floor.
Thank you. My comment is on mergers. I'm not sure if that's a good time to. It's a brief comment, but I just think maybe we should consider why and when do we want to merge workshops? Because as helpful as that might be, at some point, I don't think simply merging sessions because they're on the same topic is valid. It seems that what we're doing is sort of figuring out similar hashtags, which is a fine thing. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. And maybe for next year, because I'm thinking of what we can do better next year, maybe we can have on the submission form for the speakers, maybe we can actually sort of confine them to certain hashtags so we can better, you know, do things into categories, and then also have the workshops searchable by speaker, so that if you can click on a speaker's name, you can immediately figure out how many sessions is that speaker on, And you can maybe rank them according to the number of sessions each speaker is on. So if we have one speaker that's on, you know, five sessions, then immediately that may be a sign. And maybe actually the system can have a maximum number of submissions that one speaker can be on, and then it can flag to, like, if somebody else is trying to submit a session with the same speaker, then the system would flag out something that says, you know, that speaker is already has already reached the maximum number of sessions or something, and that would save us some.
The future is looking brighter than this afternoon, for sure. For sure. Thank you, Rasha. So I guess then we're ruling items 160 and 30 in, again, for the moment, in this exercise of the top 80. Okay. Then Chengatai is going to give us the next batch, which would be 67 through 70 Excel line items. Actually, I have it here if you want now. Their ID numbers 91, 266, 108, and 20. Again, it's just the 467 through 70 Excel line item numbers. Any overall comments, reflections? Did any of the raters in your notes have any concerns or anything that you think we should bring to the attention? Give everybody a minute to look through them. No. I'm guessing no strong objections to them and no concerns either at the sala. Are you looking for the floor? Oh, sorry, I couldn't. Igor, you have the floor, and then Michael.
Thank you very much. Just had a comment on 108. We were just chatting about it. That I think it's a very important topic, a very good proposal. But it seems a very popular one as well. And, you know, taking this opportunity, I also wanted to second everyone who was supporting our effort to try to, if not merge, then at least to try to encourage to merge. This is a perfect example. 108, I've designated that I've found at least five other proposals, 14, 21, 43, 121, and 174. You know, looking from a participant's perspective, and I was at a MAG, at the IGF for several years in a row, I sometimes feel I'm frantically trying to run from room to room, trying to be present in all these events. And then at the end of the day, I find myself that I haven't really learned more simply because I've heard the same thing over and over again in the different rooms throughout the whole big venue. Using this example, just wanted to second the idea of maybe trying to encourage to merge these as well. Thank you.
So can you give us those, I think there were five ID numbers as well, and I think we can go away and look at them for commonality.
I've identified 14, 21, 43, 121, and 174.
Once again.
14, 21, 43.
Right. Chengatai has noted them from the transcript. Thank you, Igor. Michael, you have the floor.
Yes, thank you very much. This is a similar situation where we have two sessions that are quite similar. The one on right of access in Latin America, which number is that? That's 266, right? I would actually propose that you merge that with number 194, which is actually ranked a little bit less. It's 93rd on our list of evaluations, but that one is on the Internet Bill of Rights and the right to access. I think one of the problems with 266 is that it's just Latin America, and if you combine these two, you'd have a much larger audience looking at some of the same issues, which is how do you get governments to make access a right as opposed to a luxury. Thank you. I would not support including 266 unless we did the merger to make it broader and more interesting to a broader audience.
There's a few more people in the queue, and then we'll come back to that point, though, because that was a pretty clear statement from Michael that he wouldn't support it unless some of the deficiencies were addressed and the merger. So, Juan, you're in the queue.
Yes. Thank you. I want to endorse what the gentleman said, and I want to do a proposal because this is about quality education that, as you know, is the four sustainable development goals, the four, quality education. So I think that we should, in those development goals, like this that is four, three that is health, we should try to align all the workshops in a way, as the gentleman said, that not only that it's not have repetition, but even if they're not repeated and we're still having two, not to have it at the same time, so people that are interested in that particular development goal to go on. And I want to add workshop 8 to the list that he gave about quality education. I think that we should take a look, because that's important, education for this year of sustaining developing goals.
Thank you, Juan. I just had a little conference with Chengatai, and I think what we're thinking of doing at the moment is taking all these suggestions of these sort of groupings, the Internet of Things from earlier, this one on education, identifying those numbers. The secretary can go back and identify which ones we've rated in the top 80, so that we know if there were 12 there, that there are two, and then I think you know, those MAG members that feel strongly that it's worthy of more review to determine whether or not we've you know, looked at merger opportunities appropriately, or we're putting the best workshops forward, can go away and look at those in those thematic blocks if you want, and we can come back and take another look at them tomorrow. So we're trying to capture these kind of large discussions where people have said there's a lot of similarity and commonality, and maybe they could be judged later against a fuller picture. With that, Renata, you're in the queue.
Yes. Hi. Thanks, Madam Chair. I would like to support 266, taking into account a regional perspective in Latin America. This is a very important issue, and I would definitely recommend not merging this workshop, and also the diversity of speakers is in agreement with all MAC criteria. Thank you.
Thank you, Renata. Izumi, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Regarding workshop 266, I support Michael's suggestion for a merger. And I would like to make a general observation about the workshop proposals that covers, like, focuses on regional or national perspective. I think, you know, it's still worth having these kind of proposals at the global IGF. If they actually raise the issues that's relevant to the wider global community, not just from only from the regional perspective. And in that perspective, I think Michael's suggestion seems to add value to what's relevant to the global community, not just for the Latin American community. And I also want to make my observation about merger as well. So if like a particular proposal is already complete and covers like diversity and all the criteria, we might not need to suggest merger just because it's it covers similar themes. But if a proposal has remaining issues, for example, in terms of, I don't know, not having sufficiently cover like all the diverse participants, and then by merging with other workshop that would actually strengthen the workshop, then I think a merger makes sense. So that's my general observation about the merger. And just to say that I support Michael's suggestion.
Thank you, Izumi. Igor, you have the floor.
Thank you. Just a small follow-up. Just like Proposal 108, I wanted just to add that we have a similar issue in Proposal Number 20. Again, a very important topic, aligning multi-stakeholder norms and the digital trade agenda. And this, I've actually rated it very high. I thought it was a good approach to take a broader look at not only TPP, but TTIP, RCEP and all the other agreements, but again, a number of other proposals very similar. So just to add on to the statement, I noted Proposal 56, 60, 118, and 246 as those that we could look at. Thank you.
Thank you, Igor. Jack, you have the floor.
Thanks, Chair. I want to say that while I think it's really great and important that the workshops are able to speak to the global IGF community, I think there are moments where it is important and where the strength is precisely that is focusing on a particular region or sub-region, and that the global IGF then presents an opportunity for the regional issue to also be brought to a global audience. So, for example, around Southeast Asia or Latin America, and especially, I think, for LAC, that it should somehow resonate as well to the region in which the IGF is happening.
I think those are... Could you give Jack the floor?
Sorry. Just to say, I didn't grade that particular workshop in particular. I was just speaking on basis of just in terms of principle and thinking through things, cause conflict of interest.
I think that's obviously a good practice. And I also appreciate the fact that people aren't lobbying strongly for the proposals which they or their organization submitted, because I think that would be a little inappropriate. And let me see if we can go for a close on those last two. Again, they were number 108 and 20. I think we've heard the fact that we should look at them a little more closely, and they're coupled with some other merge categories. But otherwise, it feels like at this point in the process, we are marking them in. So the next... four. Did I just do this, or is it deja vu? The next four would be line items 71 through 75, and the ID numbers are 26, 63, 264, 72, and 121. So again, we'll give everybody a moment to... Do you want me to read them out again?
No, 63. He's asking if 63...
Yes, 63 is out. That was one of the six that we asterisked to set to the side because they didn't meet the minimum requirements. So, in fact, the ones that we're actually evaluating now are 26, 264, 72, and 121. Marilyn, you have the floor.
Thank you. This is just a clarification, and I'm sorry, I just can't get online right at the moment to look up these. So we have panels again. The Secretariat has verified that those panels have submitted their background papers, and so what we're talking about, Matt, we know these have met the minimum criteria, the background papers if they're panel, and the needed report. Is that right?
The ones that I just read out, yes. Of that grouping, though, proposal number 63 does not. That was one of the ones we set to the side. The others, yes. We have an online participant. You have the floor.
Yes, I'm going to read a comment from Aida Mahmutovic, the MAG member. Support to Jack's comment about bringing regional voices to global level and giving them enough space and time from Southeastern Europe, CDIG and EuroDIG, for example. Thank you.
Thank you, Aida. Good comment as well. Renata, you have the floor.
Hi. Yes, I wanted to discuss proposal of the cybersecurity in the Global South, number 26. This was actually one of the issues that came up on the MAG mailing list. I'm not sure if this is a manual, well, only men speakers. You have an Olaf and Adli, and when I click on Adli, I go to Olaf's bio. So I noted that gender balance is an important criteria in workshop selection for this workshop evaluation. And I would, even though the theme is interesting and so on, I think this could be one opportunity for mentorship to include women in cybersecurity in this opportunity.
Yeah, I think the point's very well noted. And if it's accepted, the secretary will get back with such direction. Juan, you're in the queue.
Yes. Thank you. I'm referring to workshop proposal 72. As again, they're similar to another one in the top, that is number 9, and also similar to another down in the bottom, that is 46. And by the way, if I recall correctly, I can check, some of them are presented by the same group. So please write 9, 46, and 72. And 9 is 38 in the list. So maybe check that.
Okay, now that's very helpful. We've noted and we'll look into that. Are there any other comments in support or questioning any of those proposals down through line item 75? Looks like not. Then we will count those in with the exception of ID number 63, which is set aside because of the earlier requirements. So the next batch would start with line items 76 through 80. And the ID numbers are 153, 27, 29, 186, and 139. Juan, you have the floor.
Oh. I'm sorry to take the floor again, Chair, but I'm referring to workshop 27. It's the same topic. We have 6 proposals of the same topic. I will tell the numbers. 24, 27, 88. 88 is up in the list. I think it's numbers 15 or something. 248, 253, and 255. All related with, and this one in particular is very similar to 88, because 88 is initiatives and 27 is a particular initiative. And 88 is about initiative for child protection, and 27 is one particular initiative. So it's a very perfect match, and both are in the group.
Thank you, Juan. Eleanor, Shanghai, I were just having a quick consult on the side. Did you note those numbers, or are they noted appropriately in the transcript? Thank you. And just one second. Sorry, Jengatai was just double-checking one of the asterisk. Indonesia, you have the floor.
Yeah, back to 75. I support the ICT implementation education roadmap to achieving SDGs. I think there is no title like that before.
Okay, so you were in support of that moving forward? Yes, okay, thank you. Cheryl, you have the floor.
Thank you. I would actually like to put my full support behind Workshop 27. I understand there are a number of workshops on child sexual abuse and related issues, but I note that this is a first-time proposer. I think that the proposal is quite balanced with respect to the representation. It was well thought out, and I definitely think that this is a key topic, and so I definitely want to put in my vote to support this one. Thank you.
Thank you, Cheryl. Dominique, you have the floor.
Sure, thank you. Just to support what Cheryl said, in addition to what she said, it's actually also focused on child exploitation, which is slightly different from the other proposals. But also, it is actually a government, UK government, as Laura knows, issue. It's a UK government agenda. Sorry, I'm very tired. It's something that they do, and it's actually a great example of what they do. And the UK actually has done a lot to reach out to a lot of different countries and a lot of different regions, as well as part of their initiative. And so I think that this particular workshop actually showcases that, but also with a multi-stakeholder and very diverse group of panelists. So thanks.
Thank you. Just very quick, strong support for 139, security in the Internet of Toys, which is not the Internet of Things. The real interesting format, this is the only proposal we had for a demo, and they're actually bringing in some of these new wired toys. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Murad, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I think that 153 deserves to be included as trust building is at the heart of in international cooperation in the field of cybersecurity. I also support 27. 29 is also relevant as it addresses one of the most vulnerable groups, which are the blind, and deserves to be included in the list. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Murad. Marilyn, you have the floor.
Thank you. Marilyn Kate speaking. I've been involved in organizing child safety workshops probably from 2006 and 2007 and 2008 and 2009. I have a background in child safety. I helped launch many of the U.S. initiatives that are focused on child safety. I have two observations. Some of the workshop proposals are presented by the same people who have been presenting this issue over and over and over, and some of them are quite innovative. So the one on the Internet of Toys is quite innovative. Another one that you mentioned, Murad, which is focused on safety that is about a particular about a particular. So what I'd like to do is look at these more closely, put the unique ones into one pile, put the ones that are building on the previous speakers year over year, who basically they've contributed a lot to the literature, a lot to the research, but they are they're really repeating and building on workshops. So we might be able to merge some of those that are in that category and then maintain the really unique ones that were identified. And if we break into a smaller group, I'd be happy to take a closer look at the ones that I think could go into the clumped merger while we could protect space for these innovations.
And did you give us the ID numbers of those others that you think are in the clump?
Fine, and look at each of them, but I just wanted to comment that of the ones that were mentioned, clearly the Internet of Toys and looking at how children are affected. I did a project a few years ago that involved exploitation of new GTLDs where toys were being purchased on websites and children were being harmed by basically the parents thought they were buying safe toys. They were also in some cases buying violent games that were introducing their children to violence, but they thought it was a legitimate, so all sorts of misuses of the technology and also the internet and putting children at risk.
No, I appreciate that. I just think if you think there's a clump of workshops around that, if you can give us those numbers, we can get everybody to look at them. Liesl, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I guess for some reason this particular clump caught my eye. So first time to come in on some of the workshop stuff. Full disclosure, I recused myself from grading number 153 because my boss is listed as a speaker. So I left that one alone. But sure. But I ranked the remaining four quite high. I was also excited by the notion of demos, either whether it was for the blind or the Internet of Toys made me excited. I think my notes say if you can really bring some toys, and I suggested in my notes if they can bring a toy maker. So there might be some additional mentoring or suggestions that we could make. So I did think those were exciting. I also thought workshop 27 was a good proposal from the perspective that it takes, and also even though it has the issue is something that we discuss every year, clearly there are a lot of proposals that come in on these issues, and it is an important one. And I think Marilyn made an interesting point about it building on from previous IGFs, which I think is something we always want to see. So I like the notion of building on and taking, so we're not doing, issue X 101 every time. So I liked the building on aspect of it, actually. Anyway, that's my version on the clump. I support them all. Recuse on 153.
Thank you, Liesl. Giacomo, you have the floor.
Yes, thank you. First, just to be precise, the proposal number 29, I voted for it, but despite the fact that it's EBU, but it's EBU, European Blind Union, and not European Broadcasting. So I think there is no conflict of interest. apart from that. I want to make a reflection on the proposal about child protection. There are many more than what has been mentioned. I just tried to summarize the numbers, but at least there are 10 proposals for child online protection, and only two of them are at the moment among the eligible ones. And there are out many proposals that are, for me, are very good, like the one proposed by UNICEF or by John Carr, by Utah Kroll, et cetera, et cetera. So I would, because I think that this is, for us, one very important topic, I would suggest that we make an action as MAG, suggesting all these very important and relevant actors to try to work together in order to merge some of this, because most of the ideas are good, most of the panelists are good, but of course I think that we cannot stand 10 workshop on child online protection. So if I can suggest that we reserve a number of slots and we ask them to come back to us with a common proposal, because I think that it's a small network, everybody knows each other, so it's strange that they are not being able to. And also we have the dynamic coalition. Probably we can ask the dynamic coalition to help to streamline the proposal.
So let me make sure I understand your proposal. So you said that of the ones that identified dealing with child online safety, only two have been accepted in so far, and your proposal would be, and I would certainly support that we ask the Secretariat to go back and look at those other proposals and determine if there's either a space that could be filled in terms of an interesting view of the topic or potential merger. So I think we'll put that as an action. I will remind everybody as well that we should speak directly into the mic and not swivel our heads about, because we lose an awful lot of sound for those that are participating online. I have Miguel in the queue, and then I'm going to take a call on this last batch of five. Miguel, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Just to fully support 139, the security and the Internet of Toys, but if the Secretariat can advise them on enhancing remote participation, it would be great.
Miguel, I'm very sorry. Could you repeat what you said? Sorry.
No problem. Can you hear me now? Just to support the 139 proposal and security and the Internet of Toys, and ask the Secretariat if they can advise on enhancing the remote participation.
Thank you. So, I mean, there was quite strong support for all five of the workshops that were in this particular batch here. So I would move that we move those as well to the in list, if I can. I'd like to go through one more batch to 85, because there are five or six that we have ruled out. And if we're shooting for, roughly a good solid list of about 80 with flexibility for another 20 or 25, we can then move to some of the other categories. I also think Chengatai had an update for us on 63. Is that?
Yes, 63 did meet the minimum requirements. I'm not too sure how 63 got on, but it did meet it. It wasn't part of the four. Mm.
And that workshop was ICANN new GTLD program, exploring impact and future direction. So I will leave that one open for a moment, because we had excluded it when we were actually going through that batch, because we thought it was one of the ones that had to be set aside. If people are quiet, I'm assuming there's support for leaving it in. If not, we're looking for strong objections. Marilyn, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I rated this very low. There's a second one submitted by the Cross-Community Working Group on Internet Governance that is a cross-community working group, multi-stakeholder, that the ICANN staff attend and participate in. That one was designed by a group of stakeholders, so it shows the diversity. This one is a staff-initiated workshop by ICANN staff. ICANN has the opportunity to have a open forum. And I really think it's important to, I don't see the diversity in the originator. I would be happy to look at Nigel, but I can't turn my head away from the mic. But I gave it a very low rating, because I think that marketing the future about what ICANN is doing in new GTLDs, it's actually a very touchy subject that's not really, in my mind, well thought out. So I welcome the fact that everybody has a right to put in workshop proposals, but I want to explain that I think the other workshop proposal, which is from a diverse group of proposers, and has very broad diversity in the speakers would be the more appropriate ICANN proposal, particularly if they are also taking an open forum. Thanks.
Thank you. Renata, and then Jack is in the queue. Renata, you have the floor.
Hi, thank you. The 133 proposal, again, I hate to be the monopolist, but there is an issue on cybersecurity that IGF resource persons is a new database that is working hard by the Secretariat to bring new experts in, and especially from developing countries, in areas such as cybersecurity. So again, we have here a proposal on cybersecurity that has a huge number of names, two women invited, not on cybersecurity, and other and one name which I cannot identify the gender, but and a remote moderator, which again in the list we discussed this gender balance masking criteria of moving women to remote moderators or to rapporteurs. So this should be something that should be interesting for the MAG to look at, and also an opportunity for mentorship to bring in more women in cybersecurity. Thank you.
And if those deficiencies were corrected, you would be supportive or not of the workshop? Yes. Okay. Jack, you have the floor.
Supporting Renata. Supporting Marilyn, actually, and I think another workshop proposal that's slightly similar to 63, 64, that also went up pretty high and has been accepted in the list already.
Thank you, Jack. Now, ICANN's asked for the floor, and I want to make sure that if I give the floor to him as a non-MAG member when this day is reserved to MAG members, also that you're not simply because you can be here physically present, sort of arguing for your position, which would put at a disadvantage all those individuals that couldn't be in the room and do the same thing for their proposals. So I trust Nigel's development, implicitly. So Nigel, if you feel there's something you should say to the room, please do. Otherwise, please do consider the points I just made.
No, absolutely. Thank you, Madam Chair. No, thank you and good afternoon. No, absolutely, and recognise your point. As I think others have said, it's very difficult. Not everyone can be here. All I wanted to do was point out that this proposal was put in obviously by staff, but on behalf of on behalf of various community groups. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Nigel. So we have two questions in front of us. One is still support for the last batch of line items between 80 and 85. And then I think we do need to come back to 63 and determine whether or not there's enough support for that to go forward. The only person who has spoken about that proposal at this point is Marilyn. So the floor is open for quick support or comments against the batch of 5 and 63. So let me be really clear. There have been a lot of comments so far, all in support, some with a few things they would actually like to see addressed, Renata's comments in particular, for line items 80 through 85. So I'm looking for a sense of the room as to whether or not we count those as in, or whether or not there are any strong concerns or objections against those. Peter, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. My list, I have 69 blanked out because of some problem we were alerted to earlier. Line item 84, is that not one of our... 69 was one of our removed items, wasn't it?
Sorry, yes, you're right. 69 was one that was out. So that means I'm looking for a sense of the room on line items 81, 2, and 3, and then 85. Yeah, the ID numbers are 139, 262, 267, 126, and 143. Okay, Changatai is actually telling me that 69 is in fact fine, that the background paper was buried in subsequent links. So we only have 4 then out of the 80 that didn't meet the top level requirements. Yes, so, okay, well, it's simpler now since 69 is in fact in. We're actually looking at ID numbers 139, 262, 267, 126, 69, and 143. And there have been a few comments on that batch date. I'm just trying to look for a sense of the room in terms of whether those are in or there's more discussion required. Actually, strong support from quite a number of people on all those. You have the floor.
I would like to support that. And also 63. Those would be my observations.
Thank you, Renata. Mike Nelson, you have the floor.
Actually, I just wanted to flag something. We're now getting to the point where if we were to go back and take the ones that are on hold, we're almost to the max. So is this the last batch that we're taking?
This is the last batch we're taking out of the 85, yes.
Okay.
And is
there going to be a chance for people to nominate things that might be further down, even
that's
20
what we're coming to next.
Okay. I want to make sure I understood the agenda. Thank you.
Roughly, just so people get a sense of where we are, roughly we're probably at an acceptance rate, as we said, of about 80 workshops, with room for 100 or 105, if I remember correctly. So the plan would be that we move forward with some of the other categories and look for 25 more workshops that we believe are appropriate for the workshop program, and we'll use some of those to adjust for any of the other imbalances or any of the other categories that we want to favor. And that's some of the work that we'll prepare tonight with the Secretariat. But I have a small queue. Giacomo, you're in the queue. You have the floor.
Yes. Yes. Simply, I want to say that I was supporting the 126. I lost the number now. No, sorry.
Line item 83, safe and secure cyberspace for youth.
No, 267, sorry. 267. Yes.
I think that was a little garbled, just to make sure. You say you're supporting ID number 267, surveillance and international human rights law. Okay. Thank you, Giacomo. Juan, you have the floor.
Yeah, sorry. Chair, I'm sorry because I have my data a little bit mixed up, but around 143, my recommendation is to check because there's several above that has to do with this cyber law and all that and evidence. I know lawyers are very important for all us here, but I think they're very similar one in the top. I don't have it here now. I had a little problem here, but please check all this evidence and litigation, and there's several like that up. Thank you.
Okay. We'll note and we'll look for that. Thank you, Juan. Sheeta, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I would like to flag two issues. The first one is that from all the 80-something or 80 proposals that we have received, approved, And none of them are flash sessions. So most of them are birth of feathers or panel or breakout sessions. So none of them have flash session, though flash session is part of our innovation session. The second one I would like to ask is that if we have 80 proposals, and we have 110 or 100 rooms, and flash session only 30 minutes, so I think we can have more workshop to be approved, especially for the flash session. Thank you.
Now, thank you, Sheeta. And let me just check something. I believe there's an extra room set aside at the venue that's not in this workshop count, which could be used for flash sessions or unconference or... Is that a true statement? Looking. Pointing out quietly that, you know, there have been a number of comments over the years that there are too many sessions and too many competing sessions and things. So there's probably a decision here in the room as to whether or not we want to treat things like the flash sessions as additive to the 100 workshops, or do we want the 100 workshops to actually include flash sessions and look more as an innovative format? So I think that is a very good question. We have a queue. I think that's a – I would like to come back to that. I'd like to have a discussion, and maybe we can do that as the last – item of business. If we can just close on the two workshop discussions in front of us for the moment so we can draw a line under that and then move to that discussion, I think that will set us up nicely for tomorrow. So there's a few people in the queue. Again, the question that's in front of us is, are there any I'm looking for a sense of the room with respect to pulling in those workshops 80 through 85, and then we have the separate question still on workshop ID number 63. So that's what I'd like to close on at this particular point and then go to the flash sessions, overall workshop sessions. Renata, you have the floor.
Yes, I'd like to flag 262 again, 262 for improving gender balance. And on the issue of flash sessions, we must at some point also discuss about the innovative session formats, if we are going to simply discard those flash sessions or if we are sending proposals, orientation to submit as innovative session formats. I think that in some cases this would not be good to do. Specifically, academia has a huge inability sometimes to adapt to innovative session formats. So that would have to be something very carefully done.
Thank you, Renata. Igor, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. On the last badge, just a couple of quick comments. Proposal 126 deals with cyberspace and concentrates on youth. It presents solutions for Africa and Asia. And I did see a number of panels that also concentrates on youth, or at least in the description, mentions youth as an important factor when talking about safe and secure cyberspace, 26, 65, 113, and 115. So I was wondering maybe if we can see whether there is any ground for cooperation. On Juan Alfonso's comment regarding proposal 143, I am actually a lawyer, and if I would say something on behalf of lawyers, I would say 143, if we had to choose, would probably be one of the most important ones. Yes. So my comment there would be to leave that. And then the last one is, I believe it's 267, that deals with another very important issue of human rights law. And is it?
Human rights law.
Yeah. 267. Again, just wanted to say that the idea of surveillance and international human rights law, a very important topic that I would support. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I've got quite a long queue now, and I really would like to, so Bianca will be the last one. I really would like to hear from people direct to the question in front of us, which is there a sense of support in the room for pulling in those last five, and then again we have 63. I do want to come back to the flash sessions and number of overall sessions and get a sense of the room before we leave tonight so that we can factor that into whatever other evaluations the Secretariat goes away to do tonight. So if you want to speak directly to support for that last batch of five, please remain in the queue. If you were opening up another topic, I'd like you to hold that for the moment. So Jack, you're next.
Thanks, Chair. 69, proposal number 69 is actually quite similar to proposal 68, which has already been accepted. It's workshop number 60. Same proposer, some overlapping in speakers, talks about topic but from different directions, and I think this is one that is really, really good for a merger since it's really the same people. So I would recommend that quite strongly. And then the other one is 126. Again, I'm really wondering if there are any youth speakers on a session that's talking about youth, especially proposing solutions for youth. So questions around this, around youth speakers as well as regional representation.
Thank you, Chair. Peter Dangay-Thrush. I was going to speak very strongly against number 143. And it was one of my examples of some good ideas that got completely lost, if you like, and didn't meet any of the criteria. And I begin with, if you like, the title, How to Acknowledge Cyber Evidence, Reform New Parallel Law. So there's three or four different topics in there. When you look at what they're trying to cover, it's not clear what it is they're trying to achieve, and they've taken on virtually the entire topic of internet law as it stands. Then I come to the first line, the workshop format. The workshop format is clearly described to be a way of taking a topic that's been dealt with in a number of ways and brainstormed in various forma and is at a ripe stage for taking to workshopping. This doesn't meet any of those criteria. This is actually one of these disguised or mistaken panel formats, and when you look at how they're going to do things, they're going to bring people forward, introduce them, they're going to talk, and then someone's going to come and sum up exactly as if it was going to be a panel. And I could go on through, this is some good ideas in here, but look at the range of topics, conventional format of legislation. Books are written about that. Trade, cross-border relations, administration and working procedures, the governmental procedures, comparing the real world with what happens online. That's just one of five. There's a whole topic on evidence and how evidence for online activity should be treated with different, every one of these topics is enormous and couldn't possibly be covered in a session such as they propose. But any one of those things and any one of these people and any one of, this was the kind of thing that led me to say we should go back to these people and say, how do we help you turn this into a set of proposals or a proposal? But as it currently stands, I gave it a very low score, and I can't see it proceeding in its current format. Thanks.
I actually see quite a number of heads nodding around the room in agreement with that. So maybe we can note that as one where, similar to the clumps or possible mergers we're looking at, we take a look at that and determine whether or not we think there's room for that in the program and what we might do to actually make it more acceptable. Thank you. Did you have another comment quickly?
I'm happy to do what I said should be done and help do a reach out to these people and try and turn it into something. I don't want to just be negative about this.
So Chengatai is just saying that we'll indicate it as accepted upon the conditionality of going back and addressing some of those concerns. But I see some faces not supporting that in the... Let me, for right now, let's just say that that's asterisk, it's set aside. If we really think that there's a dearth of topics dealing with law and the internet, that we can come back and revisit that and figure out how we make that really shaped such that it fits in the proposal. Okay? Laura, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to flag a concern over Proposal 69, which is ICTs for Smart and Sustainable City. The panel is quite large, and I was just concerned that it didn't allow much room for discussion in that session. So I think, and if we wanted to accept that one, just some amendments to that panel need to be made, because there's still another there's 8 confirmed speakers, but there's another few on the list of proposed speakers that haven't yet confirmed, and I just think that's a bit unwieldy.
Thank you, Laura. That was also identified as a potential for merger, so maybe we can also asterisk that, set it aside, and look at it for a merger capability and or a more rational session. Miguel, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Just to point out that Proposal 126, we are facing here the same problem as the previous one from Latin America. It's just for one region, and it should be global, I think.
Well, it is actually for Asia and Africa. And I'll also note the comments that were made earlier by some that said there's still a lot of value in having regional as it means global and vice versa. But I will also note at the same time that we haven't had anybody else speak against that one. Out of that cluster of 5 right now, 69 and 143 are the ones that have not had unconditional support. So Miguel's asking for a small follow-up. Miguel, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Just I was telling this because I want to follow for the same criteria for all the proposals, not to take different one for each one. Just that.
Thank you. Liesl, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to say, so my interpretation of the conversation might be a little different than what you said, so that's why I maybe made a face. On 126, which is the safe and secure cyberspace for youth, I think there was a comment earlier that seemed to be more of a candidate for merger with other very similar workshops. So, which was a comment that I had, that in and of itself it might not be strong enough. So I had rated it low. I would actually think that conversation, and maybe with Miguel's comment as well, means that it shouldn't be considered as a maybe it should be asterisked to be set aside, actually. Along with 143, and I just wanted to come in on that one to say I had also a similar reaction as Peter, so I wanted to support his comments, but add a couple issues. Currently, if you are going to follow up with them, I think there is some good nuggets in there as well. I think forensic evidence is kind of an interesting topic that we don't deal with very often. But there's no government or industry speaker on there now, and it would be great if we could actually get a law enforcement person to speak on a panel like that. So just if you are reaching out, those would be my additional comments. Thanks.
That's a good comment. Thank you. 2 more folks have come in after I close the queue, so I'm going to allow them in with brief comments. We've got about 20 minutes left, and I really think we should have at least a beginning discussion on the innovative sessions and flash and total number of sessions. So at the moment in the queue, I have Bianca, then Giacomo, then Ephraim. Bianca, you have the floor.
Hi, I wanted to speak on workshop number 84. I think it's a good idea, though. I think there might be workshops that I need to find again, you know, that might be able to kind of like chime in on, you know, like to merge. But one thing I noticed that, you know, their speakers, you know, I don't see any of them from, you know, Africa or Asia. So I think that's important to, oops, sorry. I was talking about the one on, like safety and mobile. I'm sorry, I just lost 126. Okay, I'm sorry, I just lost that number. I don't see any of the speakers from Asia and Africa, which is the region that they're focusing on, right? So I think that's something that can be addressed. And also, you know, bring in youth. I think that's another comment I want to make.
Very, very good points. Thank you. Giacomo, you have the floor.
Yes. A little bit lost on numbers, but there is a number. Excuse me. computer does not answer to my request. His number 63, that was, for me, it's quite important because we are now in the middle of a big discussion, so I want to just support that this is something that we need to go for it. If there are any improvement that could be requested, of course, we can work on that, but I think it's crucial in this moment because it's in the middle of the discussion in many other places, and IGF need to be present on this discussion too.
Thank you, Giacomo. Ephraim, you have the floor.
Okay, this is regarding workshop 126. Just to emphasize, this is an experience which we had last year in Brazil. A workshop was set in a similar manner with experts. I recognize the experts. I recognize some of the names. But not, these are not the same names which were there. And in that workshop, it was focused on youth, but it was, sorry to say this, but old people, white people, and then they focused on countries which were developing countries. And then when the people in Brazil, the young people, raised the question on some of their research, they were told, shut up, we are the experts here. This is something that Marcus pointed out, was told, and Yanis, the former MAG chair, and we would like to insist on this workshop too, and not just this workshop, that any workshop that focuses on youth, despite experts having researched on this, they should try as much as possible to kind of include remote and accept views from people who kind of would want to challenge some of their views on this. So just my caveat on this was that they should find a way of more remote participation and more people from those countries that they are focusing, those regions that they are focusing on, to include them in this discussion. Just for us not to have a repeat of what happened in Brazil. Thank you.
Thank you, Ephraim. I think that's an important conversation. Let me see if I can try and close on this. I think from the last batch of five, there was support for 139, 262, and 267. I think there were conversations which I would say mean we asterisk ID numbers 126, 69, and 143. And there were some, I think, fairly substantive comments raised by multiple people in each one of those three workshops. And I think we should just determine what we need to do to actually bring the acceptance up in the room of those more quickly. So, Ephraim, your comments, particularly on 126, if we can put together some concrete suggestions for things we think should be done to improve that workshop. You had a couple, and Bianca had a couple as well. Then I would expect they could probably go forward. So, I guess conditionally, in your words, Shengetai, would be 126, 69, and 143. With respect to 63, we've had three comments on it. Marilyn supported the cross-community working group workshop proposal. I'm not even sure if that's in the top 80 or not, on the basis of this other one on GTLDs was an ICANN staff support and lack diversity. Giacomo supported it, but I would suggest that as Nigel and Renata actually supported as well, Nigel and Marilyn are so close that perhaps they can work together and make that a merged proposal, which would have the appropriate diversity. So we will work to merge 63 with whatever the other workshop proposal number is that Marilyn had referenced. I don't have that here. Marilyn, you have the floor.
That the other proposal, which comes from the Cost Community Working Group at ICANN, which is a diverse group that includes staff, has board members as observers, I might see one of them in the room, is actually about a totally different topic. It is also a very well-developed workshop that has been peer-reviewed across the ICANN community. But it really doesn't lend itself to inserting what is an update on ICANN staff's interest in the next GTLD round. They're very different topics. So sorry about that. I should have been clearer. Sorry. It's number 64, right?
Can staff proposals number 63? We don't know what
I know, but
your
I
proposal
thought Aubrey
is.
Said it was 64.
Oh. Well, let's. Why don't we just table that for a moment? And so I think we can go away and look at those two proposals. I do also note that I expect that ICANN does have, as was stated earlier, an open forum, and perhaps that's a more appropriate place if it really is simply, and again, if it really is simply an expose of the GTLD program. Perhaps that belongs more there. But let's just asterisk that since it was rated fairly high, and we'll come back and look at it again tomorrow. So where I think we've ended up at this point in time is there's probably roughly, I don't know, maybe 76, 78 proposals that are in that haven't been asterisked and or set to the side. The Secretariat, and they have very kindly, Juan, I understand that Juan, Mike, and Flavio have volunteered to work with the Secretariat to help do a little, and Sala as well, to help do a little bit, or maybe this was from Sala. Anyway, three or four people have very kindly volunteered to work with the Secretariat to help look at the statistics and the profile so that they can actually give us a picture of the sort of current diversity characteristics of the current 76, 78 workshops that we've rolled in. And we should all be looking for that in our mailboxes later on tonight or first thing tomorrow morning. And we can use that as the platform tomorrow to go away and look at any of the other imbalances we might want to address or any of the areas we might want to pull up. Developing country, first-time proposers, if there's some really interesting panels that come through the standard deviation look. So I'll address that tomorrow. What I'd like to do in the 10 minutes we have left, I think, is to have a conversation to start to advance the innovative format discussion. There's a couple of components to that, I think. The first one, and I saw a lot of interest when we brought it up a few moments ago, is a discussion on whether or not those innovative sessions, such as a flash session or on conferences, should be in addition to roughly 100 workshop slots, or should they be, should they actually be integrated within those 100 workshop slots? Again, one of the comments we have heard over the years is that there are too many competing workshops, too many choices, too many, and this would certainly be expanding the number of events. Changita, I don't know if there's anything you want to add to that introduction and then open the conversation up.
Yes, I just want to echo and underline what Lynn has said. Over the years, always, after the meeting, there's always a call that it's too big, there's too many sessions. We have 11 concurrent sessions going on at the moment. And then when we come to this point in the year, since we have the problem of fitting, you know, 260 workshops into a smaller space, we want to expand. So I would caution against expanding as such, my personal view, because we have 163 sessions. We have 11 concurrent. If we have an additional room, four flash sessions, et cetera, that will be 12 concurrent sessions. So it just gets more and more complex, and that 11th room is not resource neutral. I mean, it's a lot of resources. Yes, there's a room now for this year. We can use it for other things, you know, but for flash sessions, we've already had flash sessions using the workshop room. So I think we should keep those there. If there's something else we can use the room for, then it's okay.
So we have a short queue, but I also want to point out, did somebody say that, in fact, of the 85 that we've reviewed, and not all are in, that there are no flash sessions, which came through? I don't know if that's right or not. Somebody did state that, so we should. Sheeta said she did, in fact, state that. So it's certainly something we should go away and look at. I have Marilyn in the queue, and again, the interpreters need to leave at the top of the hour, and I suspect others do as well, so if we can just keep our comments brief and just try and get a sense of how we want to treat the flash sessions versus the 100-odd workshops. Marilyn, you have the floor.
Thank you. Marilyn Kate speaking. Chair, I speak in support of prioritizing the 30-minute blast sessions that we received proposals on. My personal belief is we invited those proposals. I feel like we have a commitment to prioritize them if we have space for them and treat them in our total number. I understand the idea of some other innovative, I don't know what they're called, maybe poster sessions, 10 minutes each or something like that, which we talked about yesterday. I think that's very different because then somebody stops in and they spend 15 minutes instead of having coffee. Those poster sessions are different than the flash sessions. And so I speak in support of putting some flash sessions in from the 30-minute flash proposals that we received.
Thank you, Marilyn. We have an online participant, Anya.
Yes, I'm going to read a comment from Aida, the MAG member. I would like to support point by Bianca and Ephraim on making sure that if we are talking about youth, then they have to be at the table as speakers. And since we are talking also about representation, please do make sure that we don't have panels talking about gender equality anymore. Let's at least fix this. Women and panels as a must. Having said that, I would like to endorse workshop 164 and 127, one from developing perspectives that actually include their points of view and not someone else's, which is very important. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Aida. Miguel, you have the floor.
Yes, this is Miguel. As Marin just said, the flash sessions we were talking about in this working group are different. That's the flash sessions, and we don't intend to compete with the existing ones, with the proposals existing. That's why we are trying to set a space during breaks to do them. So it would be like an alternative for the ones who wasn't selected to have a space, a little space during breaks. And the young conferences is another different format that we will need a space, but it's just for an afternoon.
Okay, thank you, Miguel. I think that's very helpful, and we'll probably need reminding of that tomorrow morning as well when we move forward. I have Sheeta and Liesl in the queue, and then Victor to say a few words before we leave. Giacomo, if it's really important, I'll allow you in, but just need to watch the time here. Sheeta, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would like to clarify that only one session, only one flash session in this 80-something proposal that we have approved. And if because it's only 30 minutes, I guess we can have more flash sessions. As Chengatai mentioned earlier, there is one workshop session, one workshop group that designated for flash sessions. I assume if it's only 30 minutes, then we can have around 12 flash sessions per day. Thank you.
Thank you. And I think this is another diversity characteristic we'll have to look at with the workshop proposals. Liesl, you have the floor.
Thank you. Part of my, intervention was going to be a question about the number of flash sessions that would be able to take up the workshop slot. So whether it's two or three, I wasn't sure. So I wasn't sure what new number it gives us for how many flash sessions we could have. So perhaps that's something we could revisit tomorrow. I'm also really surprised that out of the 80, there's only one flash session that made it in. Maybe in my mind, it was ones that maybe should be flash sessions. But anyway, we should look at that more carefully. But thanks for the information.
I agree, we should look at it tomorrow. Giacomo, you have the floor.
Yes, I got a message from Thomas Schneider that about new formats. He was simply recommending to consider what he suggested yesterday in the open consultation when he, through the remote participation, expressed this form that they used in the IGF Switzerland that worked very well, where there were no panelists at all and was purely discussion based on a list of questions. Probably something that we need to exploit and to test during this IGF.
Thank you, Giacomo. It's a very interesting idea. Renata, you did come in the queue after, so if it's short, because I really do need to give Victor some time too. So you have the floor.
Yes, it's very short. About flash sessions again.
in different formats. 169 is a flash session with youth and women proposals, and 127, which Aida just sent in her remote participation comment, is a tutorial, which is also another new format akin to flash session. And again, we should think about reevaluating those flash session proposals. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Renata. And Victor, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just wanted to take the opportunity to say thank you to you all. Sadly, I actually won't be here tomorrow. I need to take off. I need to be back. Yolanda will be taking my seat. You all know her. You all know that she's extremely well versed and that we're really interchangeable in many in many ways. So we report to the same structure. We're knowledgeable as to the same topic. So I really feel free to approach her. You know, she's completely open to any conversation, any feedback. We're already getting some feedback within the website, so we're quite happy to tell you that we're reading all that. So thank you for those of you who have been reaching us through there. So we'll continue to be in touch. I really want to congratulate any and all of you for the interesting, challenging, and very engaging debate that's been happening. It tells really about the value that you put into the IGF and also the responsibility that you all have towards, you know, making this an extremely good and valuable event to us all. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Victor. So if folks are okay, I mean, again, respecting the interpreter's time here, we're going to go away. I volunteer to stay as well and figure out what we can do in terms of helping to move forward tomorrow. I think there's a number of topics we need to bring back, open forums, main sessions, obviously the innovative sessions, overall number of formats. But I think with some good prep work tonight, we can set that discussion up fairly well tomorrow. So I'm feeling pretty confident that we'll get through what we need to do here. And I believe we will have an appropriate amount of time to go back and ensure we've got the right balance across a number of diverse sort of characteristics. So I want to thank everybody for sticking with the process. I know it's not the easiest or the most fun. I can't imagine how happy Victor must be to have another meeting to go to tomorrow. But I really do. I really want to thank everybody for all of the effort and support. And we are back here tomorrow morning in the same room at 10. And those of you that are going to the retreat, please pay attention to the new luggage drop-off point, I guess. Are there any other administrative points? No? Thank you all very, very much. Thank you to the interpreters. Thank you to the... Thank you to the transcribers. Thank you very much. And thank you very much to all those that are participating online. I can only imagine how frustrating. But really appreciate the comments. And, of course, to the secretariat for all the work they did late last night. And in anticipation of all the work that will go on tonight as well, a pre-thanks. A pre-thanks. So thank you. Thank you very much. And I release the interpreters. Such power. thank you all. Thank you.